place my finger like that, it's time to begin. And she said, I tell the parents, I want the attention of every person in this room. Nobody is to say a word. Your eyes are to be fixed on me. By the way, she stretches to be 5'1". And she wears between a size 2 and a size 4. And I said, you just don't mess with these little women.
Small little thing.
But the reason I had this out after the day, at the week, I mean the day after, that I want you to be engaged here, and I want you to be able to ask questions, give your input, and I want everybody to hear it. And I found out long ago, if I give something out at the beginning that the students hadn't looked at, then they keep looking down at it. So I will always be giving you a sort of a summary, sort of a general outline, after what I talked about the week before. And first thing I want to do is I'd like to take about 10 minutes and introduce as many of us as we can. And your name, just something to identify you. I'll start. Deacon John McCulley, I was ordained in 1979 and taught at Iowa State for 39 years. And then, at the request of the Archbishop, I took early retirement to work full time in the church, and that's what I'm doing. Mary.
I'm Mary Lynch, and I'm originally from Northeast Iowa and West Union. Went to Iowa State in computer engineering and was employed until I had kids, and then 3 or 4 children, and I've kind of been staying home and doing things with them since.
And Judy Buttermore, we moved here from near Pittsburgh.
Fine. And do you have any question at all about anything we've talked about? Or okay. Kathy, I'm going to pick on you today.
Okay.
I'd like you to start reading at Genesis 2, chapter 2, verse 3. Before I go any farther, I want to remind you there is a restroom right there, and nobody will be concerned if you get up and go. I may have to excuse myself for that matter. And also, I hope all of you know I love questions. No question is inappropriate. You know the statement, don't you? The only question not asked.
The only dumb question.
Yeah. That's the one you don't ask. No, there are no dumb questions. But the main thing I want us to do is just be comfortable, and we're going to go through the scripture and focus on God's wonderful love to us and the way He keeps, you know, God has done everything divinely possible to reach out to us. And again and again and again, well, the scripture says again and again and again, and maybe you can add another again. We have been taught ways, different ways. God has reached out to us, tried to help us to understand His great love and covenants. The focus on covenants is indeed a wonderful way to look at it. And we'll go all the way through the whole Bible. I'll be talking about, I've simplified the way we look at it, I think, to unilateral and bilateral covenant. A unilateral, you might call it a promise. It's God's gracious love reaching out to us. Bilateral, there's a kind of an agreement. Sometimes a unilateral covenant will have a bilateral follow-up. And so we'll be talking about all of these things. I told you that we will be looking at the Edenic covenant, and we haven't even gotten to it yet. We'll be looking at the Adamic covenant at Eden, in Eden, covenant with Adam, covenant with Noah, covenant with Abraham, covenant with the people of Israel. It's often called the Palestinian covenant. So that's the term I've put in there. The covenant with David, the covenant which the prophets speak of as the new covenant that God will make, and then the new covenant in Jesus Christ. And I will want you to be aware that as we look at the individual covenants through the Old Testament, you're going to find that when we get to the New Testament, every single one of these covenants is picked up in one way or another. I have always just, I find that just amazing. And so I would like for us now to begin with chapter 2, verse 3, which may seem like a strange place, but I hope you'll understand momentarily why. Kathy, I tell you what. First read Genesis 1:1, okay, and then Genesis 2:3.
In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth.
And then Genesis 2:3.
Chapter 2, verse 3. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation.
And the next one.
These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created.
Notice in this, you have a beginning. In the beginning, when God began to create, or in the beginning, God created. I think I told you why you have those two choices, because it's ambiguous. It's not clearly one or the other, and it's not clearly one as opposed to the other. The grammar is confusing. That's what Hebrew scholars tell us. So some, you'll notice in some of your translations, it's in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And others, when God began to create. And they're interesting. There is a Jewish translation that goes, God's continuing creation of the earth. I find that interesting. And I looked at a note to see why that choice was made. And here was the response. This is not a sequence. It's an eternal, ongoing process. Yeah, that's right. Makes sense, doesn't it? Well, if I could pick up Jesus' words in that context. Jesus said, I am working, and my Father is working still. So we haven't reached the seventh day yet. I was really pleased to find that translation. I like it. And so notice, this is a story that began, says Emma, and then it ends. Read that last sentence, please, once again.
These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created.
Okay, notice, these are the generations or beginnings. Literally, that's beginnings or generations, same word. These are the beginnings of the heavens and the earth when they were created. Question? Notice, that's a complete story, begun and ended right there. We'll pick that up later. In fact, the text will pick that up later. All right, now continue, Kathy.
In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens.
Okay, now I want to stop there because I've mentioned to you day is used in all kinds of ways, just as we use it now. The word in Hebrew can be translated that way. At this day and time, day and night, all of these different meanings of day. And notice, what did you notice about the difference in the order in those two statements? Earlier, it was... notice in the verses. Now the focus is going to be more specific. And what we've looked at, we saw God taking chaos, disorder, nothingness, making order and fruitfulness. Everything in chapter 1 says abundance. And that will continue. So, okay, now start again, Kathy.
In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being.
You've never seen me wait that long to interrupt, have you?
That was a long time.
Okay, I wanted you to get that whole. Now let's look at the parts. Okay?
Start at the beginning.
Yes.
In the day that the Lord God made the
okay,
earth.
Okay, Lord God. Okay. Notice, in the first it was God. In the second is Lord God. Okay? In Jewish tradition, you do not pronounce God's name. The word there is this. Hebrew doesn't have any vowels. So the word Adonai, a Lord, a my Lord, is replaced. So now, I'll just mention this briefly. This indicates a different ultimate source of writing down. Because and you're going to find that, in fact, I'm mentioning it now because you're going to see in chapter 6, how this is, begins to be put together in a, an interesting way. Okay, so the Lord in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Keep reading.
When no plant of the field was yet in the earth.
Now notice, in the other story in Genesis 1, what did you have first? What was the very first thing God made?
Light.
Then what? He separated the waters and so on. And notice, fourth day, luminaries. Fifth day, notice it's sometime before you have plants. So it's sometime before you have plants.
Thank you.
And now here, notice. By the way, it's the very last of God's creations in Genesis 1. Okay? And the word is Adam, but I shouldn't capitalize it because it's not the name of a person here. Adam and was man male or female?
Both.
Right.
Okay, and that's what the word means. Adam means people, humankind. Question? What's the word for an individual man? For an individual woman? By the way, you will see slight variations in the way the Hebrew will be spelled because you have how do you transliterate another alphabet a totally different way. So anyway, this will, I hope this will suffice. Okay. Man was the last to be made, male and female, right? Notice, you were building up to the big moment. I was going to read something in the catechism. Since I forgot to mark it, I won't go to it now. But in the Catholic catechism, you have the statement, the literal always takes precedence. You begin with the literal in reading the scripture. By the way, that's from St. Augustine. That's from St. Thomas Aquinas, and so on. I mean, it's, but literal is not our literal. Our literal is more, well, shall I say, our literal is fact. I think that we have not recognized how much we have become believers in fact instead of believers in truth. I think I mentioned to you last time what one minister told me as we were talking about the Bible. He said, if you find one statement in the Bible that is not absolute fact, then the whole thing goes like a row of dominoes. And I told my wife, I'm not talking to him anymore. His faith is too fragile. And if we have to have fact for it to be true, it's not a fact. Think about it. A fact has to be verifiable by an outside source, right? Is that fair enough? Okay. It's not a fact.
He's an outside source. He's an outside source.
No, God is not a fact. And so, you see why I say there are people who believe in fact over God. And so, this has been very destructive to faith. Because what do you hear many people say? Huh? Superstition. You know this, right? Okay. Very important to distinguish between fact and truth. All right. In the first story, man is the last created. Okay, Kathy, you've already read. What was the very first thing made in the second story? I want you to read it once again. In the day that the Lord God.
In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth.
Notice, no plants, clearly no animals either.
Yeah.
Skip to verse 7.
Then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
Notice, what is the very first of God's? Okay. And it's the same word that is used. Except this time, it's a man and Adam. Okay, and then notice, in this one, it was last. In this one is first. Okay, what would you call that? A factual contradiction? Agreed? Okay, now, the catechism itself says we must read within its own context and within its own genre. Now, what does the word genre mean?
Category.
The type of writing. Well, it's poetry. There's poetry in the Bible, you know that. Whether it's a play. Did you know there's a play in the Bible? It's a Greek drama. The book of Job is in the form of a Greek drama. I mean, they're animal fables. All sorts of things. Who are we to say what God can and cannot use to communicate his truth? Really? So, okay, now in the first story, you know, it was in the beginning, God said, let there be light. It was light. It was the first day, second day, and it was so, and it was good. By the way, I tried to give you that in that handout. Notice? And it was good. That series, then God said, let there be, and there was, and it was good. And there was evening and morning, right? Okay. The genre, the type of writing you got, you're building up to the big moment. So, if you're building up to the big moment, what is the big moment here in Genesis 1? Creation of man. Okay. Now, in the second story, man is made first. And then what? Everything is going to be made for him. Okay, in Genesis 1, what's the most important of all God's creations? In Genesis 2, what's the most important of all God's creations? Order of climax versus the order of priority. Question. I know that this is kind of hard to get your head around sometimes, because this is the way, this is not the way we think. But this is the way the scripture is written. And so, by the way, I use the term pre-factual in regard to the Bible. Notice I did not say non-factual. I said pre-factual. Because all of the facts, that is, all of the details, and that's what a fact is, isn't it? All the details, all the facts, are there for a purpose other than themselves. And so, and the word fact, which comes from the Latin verb, noun. Okay. Oops. Sorry. To make or to do in Latin. And that was coined in English at the beginning of the 17th century, early 1600s. The word did not exist. If you have an idea, if you have something that's current, you often have many words for it. Joan, I'll bet you've got more names for Kevin now than you had for him when you first met him.
That was too easy, John.
What's important to us, we usually have many names for. How's that?
Thank you.
All right. Now, you know the story, it may be a fable too, but you know the story that Eskimos have 14 different words for snow because they're so much a part of their lives. And there's so many kinds of things. Okay, if we don't have a name for it, how are we going to think it? I could even put it like this. These are the words that are written. This is the word that's spoken. What do you call it if it's not written and not spoken? what do you call a word? It was not written and not spoken.
Thought.
Right.
Idea?
Yes. And that's what we think with.
What'd you say?
Question?
What was that word?
Idea.
Oh. Huh.
Idea? Yeah. I've used that many times. I'm going to get off this just a moment. But this is so important, I want to spend a little time with it, if you don't mind. I ask my students, describe a cat as opposed to a dog or some of them. Okay, four legs, right? Fur. I say, how long's the fur? And you know what they tell me every time? Different lengths of fur. I say, okay, colors. Color. Oh, different colors. I said, you have described nothing in this world. A cat with different lengths of fur and different and all different colors? No, that's an idea of a cat.
Is it fair to say then we don't think like God? And is it also fair to say he's trying to make us think like him?
I think that's quite fair. I think that's quite fair. Absolutely. The scripture even mentions that kind of thing. Yeah, that's even scriptural, but that is certainly true. Okay, so now, I hope we've got out of the way any problem with, okay, the different order, because this is a different story, and it's telling us something very different. That's the reason it's here.
The only question I got is Ish a Hebrew word?
Yes.
If they didn't have a vowel, how would the I live? Yeah, we call it Ish, but what was it?
It was pronounced Ish, and that's the reason we are transliterated. We can't have a word without a vowel, except in certain names. But no, if you look at the way Hebrew is written, to get you now have ways to indicate a vowel, and you did in New Testament times. Have you? In the King James Version, that's what I grew up reading, it says, not a jot or a tittle will pass away till my word has been fulfilled. Jot and tittle, these are vowel points that are added for help. So, that's the reason I said you will find these transliterated different ways, because we're having to try to make something pronounceable from a language that has no vowels. Good question. Good point. Okay. Any question before we get started, really get started in chapter 2? Okay. Kathy? Read that again now, and we're going to be looking at parts.
From the beginning? In the day that the Lord God made the earth and heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground.
What is needed for productivity according to that?
Man
and
rain.
Water and man are to cooperate. Okay, keep reading.
But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground.
Okay, I want you to remember two passages, this one and one in Genesis 1. Genesis 1 said, God separated the waters which were above the heavens from the waters beneath the heavens. Remember this? That was Genesis 1. Now this says, a stream was flowing up from the ground, from below the ground, literally, to water the earth. Now notice it says, water the earth. It doesn't say, water this little oasis. hang on to that, because we're going to come back to that as we get to the Lord. Go ahead.
Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground.
And sometimes that can be, the same word for dust is the same word for ashes. Dust and ashes. Also, you can have clod. And I like the statement, some of us haven't gotten very far from that, have we? Go ahead.
And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
Ah, do you realize we have God's breath within us? And I told you that the word means wind. What else?
Breath.
Breath. What else?
Spirit.
What else? Connotation of, really, connotation of power. And that's the Hebrew. This is Greek, and this is the Latin, and all three classical languages have the same, they're the same. You can't say wind or breath or spirit without a context to limit it. Otherwise, it's any of those possibilities.
Is soul the same as spirit?
Pardon?
Soul.
No, soul is a different word.
It was there prior to all those.
The word soul, this is good. This, the Hebrew word for it is not a word for something apart from us. We are souls. We don't have a soul. It's a Greek concept. So, okay, we'll say there, how many here? 20? There are 20 souls. Yeah. And so a soul in Hebrew tradition, Hebrew understanding, is a person. Not something we have, but that's who we are, or what we are. We are souls. We have a body. In Greek tradition, non-Christian, we are bodies. And we have a soul. That's not Jewish or Christian to say we have a soul. We are souls.
So this lump of clay or dust has souls.
This lump of clay is a soul with a body. The clay is the body. You see? And we have within us God's breath. So, I
so
like...
So the soul is sort of like part of God. Like,
wow.
Inseparable.
Okay.
Same.
What did we read in Genesis 1? In the image and likeness of God, right? And I ask you what image of God you had in Genesis 1? A word maker. John's gospel is going to pick that up too. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Okay, and notice, Word at that point is not Jesus. And not the Jesus that we think of. And the Word was made flesh, dwelt or tabernacled among us, and we beheld his glory. Glory is the only begotten of the Father. That's Jesus. So, the gospel according to John, if it meant Jesus, it would say Jesus. Remember, I told you we are literal readers. If it meant in the beginning was Jesus, then it would have said so. Do you follow me? If it doesn't say Jesus, it doesn't mean Jesus. It means Word. In Greek, this is what the word is. Dialogue. Two people talking. So this is, yeah. Dave says God thinks differently from monks. I think we're seeing it, aren't we? Every now and then somebody will say, this is deep. Well, of course it is. It's God. It's God talk. The point is it clear? Okay, so continue, Kathy. And God breathed in the man the wind, breath, spirit of life. By the way, wind, breath, spirit of life. You could say God inspirited man in the man. Yeah, go ahead.
And the man became a living being.
Okay, at this point, Dave, that's what this word is. In some translations, you've got, a man became a living soul. Dave, there you have it. Being. So.
Do you?
I mean, one of the prayers and other things I've read that they like to use the word animated.
Animated being is animation. Yeah. Okay, Kathy.
Okay. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. And there he put the man whom he had formed.
Okay, now notice. Now you begin to see God's got the man. Now he's making everything for him. And of course it's in the east. Where else would it be? Did you know for centuries the altar was always in the east? We're backwards here. But for centuries, the church altar had to be in the east. And you see why. This is the source of everything.
They used to.
Again, see, we used to, you know, we talk about how much we have gained, and it's true. But with every gain, there is a loss. What we always hope to do is gain more than we lose. But every time we gain something in terms of knowledge and understanding, we're going to lose something. Because, and this has been so true. Remember, I'm a fossil in more ways than one. My degree is in medieval studies.
So when you're saying, like, if we just take St. Cecilia's and took it back to that where everything was facing east, you're saying our altar would be in our interest.
Yes.
And everything else would
yes.
be in
yes.
mind.
Would reverse the heat. Yeah.
But it's a, I guess man has changed it or something. The altar's still facing east.
It's facing east, but it isn't in the east.
Yeah.
But you see, we don't think about those anymore. Because that's not part of our thinking anymore. That's what I mean by we lose something. Do you see what I mean? It's not part of our thinking. You may never have heard of that before. Kathy, go ahead.
Out of the ground, the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. And the tree of life also in the midst of the garden.
All right, now every tree that is pleasing to see and good for food. And the tree of life. Keep reading.
Also in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Okay, now the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Every now and then somebody will say, well, there was a tree of knowledge in the garden. I say, no. There was no tree of knowledge in the garden. God's not anti-intellectual. There was a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now let's look at the word know. Oops. When I keep that out a little while, it dries. Okay, the word that we translate know in from Hebrew does not mean intellectual knowledge. Okay, you will remember this even though we're not there yet. And Adam knew his wife and she conceived. You remember that? Okay. The word know is the same word for sexual intercourse. Of course, you know that, Steve, don't you? I asked one day after I talked about this. Now, and I had given the definition I'm going to give you. And so I said, now, remember, what does the word know mean? And of course, the student said, sex. I like with that. I mentioned this book to you last time. This is in our library. It's the Anchor Bible Genesis, and I will recommend it highly. It's superb. Professor E.A. Spicer, who is he is one of the translators of the most popular Jewish translation of the Bible in this country, is the author of it. And he is excellent. And I like his definition better than any I've ever seen outside of that, though they're not contradictory to him. He says this word means an intimate experience of. Oops. An intimate experience of. Know the Lord, right? An intimate experience of the Lord. Remember, the New Testament says, you believe in God, you do well. The devils also believe and shudder. Believe in God. We are to know God. We are to have an intimate experience of God. And when people tell me the Old Testament taught a distant God, I say, what Bible are you reading? From the beginning. Okay, know the Lord. So, what is the tree? Okay, let's break it down. What's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? It's a tree of the intimate experience of the helpful and the hurtful. I think that puts a different tone on the whole thing. An intimate experience of the helpful and the hurtful.
And we only got it because of the fall, at least the hurtful part.
That's right.
Garden, every...
Okay, and in fact, I'm going to need to talk more about that, Dan. Good. Go ahead, Kathy.
A river flows out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it divides and becomes four branches. The name of the first is Phishon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates.
Okay, now these are just words to us, sounds. Okay, the first one, P-I-S-H-O-N, the word means bubbler. Really, just sort of like a stream bubbling up. And, okay, the word that's translated I'm sorry, that the word, that first one is gusher, like water gushing out. The meaning of the second is bubbler. The meaning of the word in Hebrew that's translated Tigris is lively, quick, like an arrow, but also like a rapids. And the name of the fourth one is bursting with sweetness. Now, doesn't that make a lot of sense in the garden? And of course, notice, remember, what kind of an area do you have here? What? This is a rock, a Iran, okay? Rock, probably.
Arrow.
Notice, water, plants. I mentioned last time, oasis. Yeah, read it.
Does enhavala also mean circle?
Does, I can, mm-hmm. It's a, in fact, yes. The whole, it's, mentioned last time that there is an illuminated manuscript with a picture of Eden. Now, an illuminated manuscript is not an illustration, it's a pictorial commentary. It's perfectly round, it's the whole earth, perfectly round. Right in the center is a baptismal font with something that looks like a church over it, and so on. And what is that saying? That it's really saying that the land was originally a garden which was also a holy place, a place where God was in its midst. And it was a place of abundance. Notice that's what it said in the first one. That's what it's saying in the second story. Circle, of course. Go ahead, Kathy.
The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it.
Okay, now, this is...
Let's go back to the other, what we were just talking about. What was the purpose of where there is gold?
Ah, this is... gold, since what? Forever, has been the most precious metal. The gold of that land is good, notice. It's not close to it. It's the real authentic stuff. So, one of the things that I want to remind you of, God is the God of beauty as well. Notice? That's a beautiful place. And it has gold and jewels. So, thanks. Okay. Go ahead.
And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat."
Notice. And now, how were all the trees of the garden described, except that one? Except this one?
Good for food.
Good for food and
pleasing to look at.
Pleasing to look at. Right? And the tree of life. Right? Those are not forbidden. Every tree that is good for food and pleasing to the eye and the tree of life. None of those were forbidden.
Was the tree of life a separate tree from those other ones then?
Yes, yes. Yes. It, in fact, in the center of the garden, you seem to have two trees, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. You got the good for food and pleasant to the side all over the place, apparently.
What, that tree of life, what was, I mean, obviously, you know, life is what we are. What was it used for in the garden? That continuous of life, or?
Remember his question. I'm going to let the text respond, okay? All right. Remember that question, because I'm going to let the text respond. Okay, Go ahead, Kathy.
Okay. But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat it, you shall die.
Okay, now, how long's a day?
It's 24 hours.
Remember, a day can be any length of time, right? Fairly immediate in this day and age. So, okay. All right. Notice the word is translated die. Again, I'm deferring to Professor Spicer and other scholars who say that means become mortal. In other words, subject to death. Now, remember what we're talking about. Ultimately, we get into covenants. We just read the first covenant. What's the agreement that God asks of man?
Don't eat of the tree
of life. Don't eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But what else? Okay, but what else
keep
you to do? Pardon?
Keep the garden.
Keep the garden. Keep the garden. What about the others?
Become fruitful and multiply.
Okay, that was in the first story. But what about, okay, and yeah, that's
like
that's
pretty. Care for the garden.
All right, okay. All right, now. Keep reading, will you, Kathy?
Then the Lord God
were inseparable. By, you see, the classical languages are what might be called synthetic languages. They put things together. Modern languages, especially English and German, are analytical languages. They separate. And when you separate things, you lose connections. And so, original righteousness of justice was their state. And so I'm going to come back to that, Kevin. Keep reading, Kathy.
Okay, let's see. Back to, Then the Lord said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner.
Okay, community is a basic idea. Notice a part of the covenant. Go ahead.
So out of the ground, Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name.
Okay, by the way, Dave, you're back to soul, creature. It's the same, okay, all of these same Hebrew word. And traditionally, the in Western civilization, everything had a soul. Question. Keep reading, Kathy.
The man gave names to all cattle and to the birds of the air and to every animal of the field.
Okay, names. This is really important because you know what God is letting man do?
Be part of the creation. Be part of the creation.
He's being part of the creation. He's calling them into being in the sense that what you name, you remember I told you that the Jewish tradition you did not use the name you substituted for Lord. And I think I told you last time, even the word God is written like this. You don't write it in English with a vowel because you can't write God because that's referring to the divine. So, to name is knowledge. Well, isn't that what we were talking about earlier? You have a word for it?
Yeah.
Okay? To name is to have the power of knowledge over. You know what it's good for? You got to tell me you know what God's good for? Do you see what I mean? The power of knowledge. That's what naming is all about. And so, yeah, man is cooperating with God. God is letting man cooperate, even telling him to cooperate, right? Remember, without man and water, you don't have fruitfulness. So man and God work together. And when they don't, bad things happen. Okay?
Did you say that, going back again, you could eat of all the trees except for the tree of knowledge? Even the tree of life?
Tree of knowledge of good and evil. No tree of knowledge. Remember?
Oh, yeah. But even the tree of life.
Yes, that was not forbidden.
What did that do?
Okay, I'm going to let the text respond to me. Good, we're getting there. Kathy, go ahead. Verse 20.
Yeah, okay. The man gave names to all the cattle and to the birds of the air and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner.
Okay. Actually, I like the original there, and I don't know why it isn't. It's a side-by-side helper. A partner is a side-by-side helper. Okay, go ahead.
So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken."
Okay. Interesting, because this is a strange little, this is a poem that she's just read. By the way, notice, interesting that side is a very important kind of a concept. Otherwise, interesting that it was the sword was thrust into the side of Jesus. Okay, so side-by-side helper, so he takes a rib and makes a side-by-side helper. That's kind of neat, I think. By the way, St. Augustine said, God made woman. Now remember, the church father. God made woman from the side of man. Not from his feet, that she should trample upon him, that he should trample upon her. Not from his head, that she should rule over him, but from his side, that she would be a side-by-side partner. That's St. Augustine, guys.
I think usually, don't you see the woman behind the man, give him a good swift kick?
And then when he gets home?
You know,
we look at the Middle East and so on now, and we think about the way things were. A lot of what we think of as the Bible is from our Puritan past. And I think we don't have any idea how much we are all influenced by the Puritan Protestant movement from Europe. But it was, do you know, it was more exaggerated in the United States than it was in Europe? That tends to be true when something is carried across, you have to outdo the original. And so that's the reason we have, you know, we don't have, we have white meat and dark meat on the chicken. You know why? That's to keep us from saying legs and breast. And that's when those words began to be used.
Dumb questions. Does one side of man's rib cage have one less rib? And does the woman have more ribs than you?
Do you know you will actually find that probably on the internet? But no, not true.
I just was wondering.
No, I think that's funny because somebody, I had a student who vows that was true. And I said, if you ever counted, don't need to. Okay, go ahead, Kevin.
Therefore,
oh, one thing I wanted to mention here. Another translation is, instead of this one shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man, she was taken out of
her
man, which is an interesting. I don't know why that isn't always used. Now, I said this was a kind of a chicken and eggs a poet because, oh boy, I got a swamp again. Remember, the word for man is this. And this is the word for woman. Okay, you can take ish out of isha, but you can't take isha out of ish. So interesting the way this works. Do you see what I mean? Linguistically, it's again, like I told you, the beginning of Genesis is ambiguous. This is kind of ambiguous as well. And by the way, this is not the only time the Bible uses this. I told you this is the word for man in the plural, humankind. Adam was taken out of. That's why. Soil. Dust. Whatever. So. Interesting, the kinds of, there are word plays all throughout the scripture. Remember, God's a word maker, and words are really important. And so, we got to be literal readers.
You said it was a word for soil and?
Ground, clay, clod, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Okay. Go ahead, Kathy.
Therefore, a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife.
Go ahead.
And they become one flesh.
Okay. Now, when you say therefore, what do you do?
For this reason.
For this reason. What is for this reason? For this reason, what? What's the... Okay, aren't you drawing a conclusion? Is that what you're doing? Therefore, summing up, concluding? Okay, notice, what is the reason for the Adam and Eve story ultimately? What's the main reason? For this reason, or therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother. And literally, it's cling to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Notice, from one into two, back to one. Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. That's okay. And notice, that's a covenant. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and cling to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Notice, man is the active one here. Man is the one who's active. And when I think about my son and my grandsons, I think, the Lord knew what he was saying. I'm telling you. I don't know about you, but I thought, boys, oh Lord. any child with any boy with McCully blood is a problem. notice, you've got covenant here. This is the covenant with Adam. Notice it has multiple layers. Let's start listing some of them. By the way, so that I get to Dave's question, I want you to skip Kathy to chapter 3. Let me see where I am. I want you to read chapter 3, verse 22.
Then the Lord God said, "See, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. And now he might reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever."
Okay, notice what would have happened if he had eaten of the tree of life? Live forever. By the way, who is the tree of life?
God.
That's later, of course.
Oh, it's time.
Yeah. The Lord God says, "See, the man has become one of us."
Yes, and we're going to deal with that next time. Okay? Kevin, did I respond to you? What would have happened if they hadn't eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Notice. What did you, what, by the way, what are the plants for in the garden? Food, right? Okay. What is man to do?
Cultivate.
Everything.
Yeah. By the way, what are the animals for?
Look.
No, not just to look at. What? Well, no, you don't eat animals yet. So the animals are not for food. What are they for?
Company.
Well, it says helpers.
Helpers.
And not side-by-side helpers, but helpers. Notice, everything in this garden is for something else. Everything has a purpose. Everything is in harmony. That was possible. Eternal. Notice, I'm going to suggest to you that ever since the Garden of Eden, we've been trying to get back there, and God's led the way. And that's ultimately where we're going to end. We're going to end in our beginning. We got a long journey and an important one all the way. And that's what we call the journey of life.
Isn't it?
But it's time for me to stop, and I'm gonna try to stop right on time. But I want to begin next time by sort of summing up the covenant with Adam. And I'd like you to be, that's your homework, okay? Think about, okay, what are all the relationships here? And how does God figure into all this? And what's involved in all this? So we're gonna begin with that. And then we're going to move to the, not just the covenant with Eden. Notice it's called the Edenic covenant. That is, it's almost like the covenant with Eden. We're going to move to the covenant with Adam. And by the way, that's humankind and all the rest. Okay?
So are we still in the covenant of Eden right now?
We have completed that.
Okay.
We completed that. And now what we're going to ask, we're going to begin a covenant with Adam. Okay? And that's the reason I say, next time I want to begin some of the covenant with Adam.